Okay. So I think we can start now. So before we start, let me check. How many of you have attended Retrospect? Maybe within your team or you have conducted? Okay. So I don't have to go and explain the basic principles. But what do we do in retrospectives? Anyone from audience? What do we do generally? Yes. We inspect and we adapt. That's the key ceremony where we go and adapt and see what is the changes we have made, whether it's working or not. Well, we have one team, we had some problems, we looked back, we improved it, and we found some solutions. That's the agile cycle, inspect and adapt, it works. It's great. But imagine we have a big group, let's say, or a big product of 10, 20 Scrum teams working on it. Or maybe we have to do a program level retrospective. How does this fit into it? Because we will have people from different backgrounds, or maybe different functional roles. We will have managers. We will have people from HR, from business, from sales. How do you accommodate all this? Will it work? The principles which I have seen with a single team? My experience, it works, but large retrospectives which I've done in my US office, plus in my India offices. And you can ask me questions anytime which you feel you need some explanation. Basic principles which you have seen with a single team holds true here also. Well, this we already know, what is the Agile retrospective. Now this is the case study which I am doing here is the first large retrospective which we did it in year 2012. It was in our US office. We had this big new program, new initiative. The top management was there, and the customer was, yes, always at our back because they had spent around maybe close to more than 20 millions. And they wanted result faster, but we are not able to scale it up. So to improve it, we added a few more Scrum teams, and plus the UI, it was a lot of UI changes also happening there. So we had a UI team also. They had the proper Scrum of Scrums, the retrospectives, everything was good. But we are not able to get the productivity, or there were a lot of problems within the team, or the cross communications, the technical adaptability, a lot of issues were there. And many of the times, these teams had to stay late to work. Well, they had retrospectives, the teams had retrospectives. But when you looked at the large program level, we found like some common patterns across the teams, which were hidden, which is not coming up to this retrospectives because the visibility of each Scrum team was up to a certain level. So then we decided, after our first phase, let's do a combined retrospective of all the stakeholders, all the feature teams, with all the business stakeholders, and let's find out what is the problem which they are not able to identify. What is the issue? Now, before you do a retrospective, what is the first thing you do in our meetings? We send an invitation to the people, and we'll say that, okay, this is a sprint first, or maybe sprint five, we are going to do a retrospective, or maybe this is a goal and all those things. So before we started, or before we did it, and the audience was so huge. We had our Scrum teams running on Agile, but we had our salespeople, our business management, the top management, the VPs. They were completely new to this. So what could we do to bring them into it? So we went with all these problems. In fact, I remember drafting all those emails, creating graphics and the problems and the cost metric analysis. A lot of data we do analysis. We send it back and try to convince the people, to the VPs, the salespeople, the business development people, and talk to them about they have to be here. And I remember there was one of our top delivery managers. He started getting so enthusiastic. He started pulling all the bug counts and all the emails, and he was sort of in a firing mode. So we had to go back, talk to this managers that this is to be a retrospective where all people are equal. So they have to remove all their manager powers and they have to come as a normal team member. And it was a very difficult challenge at that point of time. Remember talking to a VP of such a big corporation and how they reacted. But then when we presented our data and say what is we want to achieve it, they agreed. We had set the goals about some of the issues like the late working of the teams, plus the delivery which the customers wanted, and the scaling up of the product in the next releases. Then we went to make hype about this. We advertised it. Notably, we created the emails with the invitations, the all the goals. In all the pantries, the scrum teams, or the scrum areas, we just put it all these big posters, advertising such a big event. And then we blocked around 2 days, two entire days for this part. Then we asked the team to gather data, because we are doing this in around mid or maybe around August time in 2012. So it was like around 6 months after the project has started. So a lot of events or maybe multiple sprints has happened. So they gathered the data. And we had the meeting with architecture team. They brought their own initial analysis from the teams. The team started with their meetings, their retro notes, the individual team retro notes. The project managers, all those people, they started getting the data for us. And we had multiple reminders for them. And then since we had like multiple scrum teams and people from different departments, we created a group of scrum masters, or a team to work with all these people to agree a common working agreements. Because the scrum teams had a different set, plus, and maybe to an extent our direct managers would understand that. But when you talk the same thing to sales managers or maybe the business development people, it was like Greek and Latin to them. So we had to work with them, what is their priorities and how we could adapt them. So it was itself in a small project for us to get this working agreements. Then once we finalized the working agreements, we had invitation sent. Formally, we went and talked to the people, invited to this. We send email invitations with the agenda, all the goals, the working agreements, and what we are trying to get achieved by this, which was a big venue. In fact, we had to move we had like a series of seminar rooms. We removed a couple of portable walls, made a big room, removed all the artifacts from the wall. And I remember our sales facility person looking at us some precious paintings. And I thought he would kill me. But then it was fun working with those people, getting us a wall cleared. The bigger challenge I faced when I did something similar for the India team in our India office, that office was more trouble. But then ultimately, they also gave us the permission. Then we set up the venue. And their venue, we created across the wall, we put white chart papers. And then we had the working agreement space, the goals, across where every people could see it, almost all the audience could see it. And we arranged some light refreshments for the people. This was our meeting preparation before the day. And every day, every scrum team, we used to go and talk about this, review the things, because they were the people who were supposed to talk. And we had to go back again, do a coaching to our managers so that they don't come as a managers, but be only as a participant. Our opening day. Well, the fun begins. Here we had our all the people assembled on early morning. And we had people which we are seeing for the first time. I saw my counterpart in my sales department for the first time, and all other people. And the team were, we had initially planned to start with a coffee so that they could mingle each other. But then we asked everyone to introduce themselves, their name, and what's the department they are working, so that they could at least get familiarized, at least they could speak out in front of all those people. Then we started reviewing the agenda, what we planned to do the 2 days. Then we reviewed all the working agreements which has been agreed by all the people, and we called our senior VPs and other top management people to reiterate the project vision. When they started this project, they had a certain vision to this. What is their plan? What was their intention? So we asked all those people about to reiterate their feelings and how, what is their current feeling at that point of time. Then we went back to the audience, or maybe all our colleagues, and asked, how do they relate to this vision? According to them, was it a success? And well, we had a very surprising, we asked the people to raise their hands, and it was sort of a mix. It was not as a major success which we thought or originally. And it was really an eye-opener for a lot of people when they looked around and saw that the perception about the success differs a lot. And we talked about the emotions part, about what they felt, so that the people get talk to each other without any hindrance. Before even this, by the time when we were starting preparing for this retrospective, we had asked the people to gather the data about emails, the defect numbers, the stories delivered, all those things. And even some of the meeting minutes, or even some of the team retrospective notes. They brought this, and we asked them to paste across as a timeline. We had volunteers in the group who went there and added it. And we asked the people to move around and look around and see what they could add to it. What are the things they're missing in the picture? Once everything was finalized, we got some more volunteers to start explaining the story from the day the project was started and to that day. We started this because there are a lot of people who joined us in between, and there are people who left to other groups. And there are managers or maybe other department people who didn't have a complete picture of this. So after the storytelling, they were able to visualize the project as a whole. They were able to understand the emotions when the people talked about it. And I remember a couple of deep interactions when you're talking about story. Some of the people got very emotional about a couple of the stages. And this was the first time they were able to talk about their feelings and about how they planned to do it and which they were not able to. So it became a sort of platform about emotional outbursts plus some of the facts. And up to this, once we have the story, we talked about generating insights. So we had a lot of points to discuss. So what is the top points? What is the points we should be taking forward? So we formed subgroups within the team who could formalize or maybe go through all the stories and find certain discussion points. And then we had grouped this discussion points into certain themes. We had a lot of issues with our test-driven development was a big problem. Our development manager was supposed to push it across the teams. He was pushing his own version, and the team was not so happy with it. So we had a lot of discussions around that and a lot of points. So we grouped all this into different themes. And we asked the team or the subgroups to work all these individual themes and brainstorm it or find the ideas. What is the problems which you see there? Or what do you want to talk about this specific theme? We rotated people across themes, and then they brainstormed each other and find the discussion points to generate the insights. And once we finished this exercise, in fact, it was the end of the day one, we asked the people to go back and sleep over the points which we discussed. And the next day, because that was a purpose, we had around 1 hour left to, we could have furthered it out, but then we thought it would be a nice stage where could we stop it and go back so that people could mull over all the points they have seen it or heard about it. The next day when we came back, again we reiterated our vision, our agreements, so that people don't forget about it. After that, we asked the people, the subgroups, to go and discuss it, the themes. What is the problems? Present the top things, or not the, present all the issues. And then we asked the group as a whole to go and prioritize the points in each theme. We gave colored dot sticky notes. For it was red and green, which we use really too. Red means it was need for improvement. Green was best, keep it up. So based on this prioritization by the entire group, we were able to identify the top three points which needed our attention for improvement, and another three which was to be kept on. And once we did it, we again had our analysis, came back, or the problem areas. We asked the teams to go with like couple of analysis metrics, which we explained, like Fishbone or Five Eyes, couple of other, but they were free to take any of their analysis methods. They analyzed it, and they found what is the problem, what is the issues which they were trying to tackle it. And they formalized the action plan. But let me ask you a question. You have done a lot of retrospectives within the team. What is the problem which you have seen it? Anyone? Which you feel the retrospective didn't work? Any? Why? I will add to this point, because this was a very big discussion point at that point of time. Why one of the person said it to me that all the things you are doing, it's great, but it's not going to work. And I was surprised. We put so much effort, energy into this, and this person openly saying that does not work. So why does it work? Why doesn't it work? Because all the retrospectives, his Scrum Master was doing it, just put it notes, put it in SharePoint, finished, nothing. Or maybe few things he will work on it, but there are a lot of things which they, and they were not able to view the progress. You have the task board in your all this sprint backlog which you see where you progress each and every day. You can visibly see the progress, but the teams, they were not able to see the progress on the retrospectives. They had retrospectives sprint after sprint, but what happened to the discussion points? How many of things were solved? How many of things were blocked? What is the status?
Retrospective points. Typically, I think retrospective points is for the team to improve rather than the Scrum Master to chase it out. Am I correct?
And yes, exactly. It's for the
team to. In fact, that particular team was in a specific way. The Scrum Master did every retrospective. The team will collaborate it. Couple of action items which was planned to the team, it will be given to the team. They will have visibility to this. But there are retrospective points which was given to the management or other people outside the team which they don't influence, which we expect the Scrum Master to go and work with those people and facilitate it. But that area, the team didn't have any, you know, visibility, because that was outside their,
I mean. Two things is, you expect an adapt doesn't start in a retrospection.
It starts on the day-to-day basis. In fact, it starts with,
according to my, it starts with your daily planning meeting.
There's something wrong. The impediment, the Scrum Master should have been able to bring it up to the management and say something wrong, right?
Exactly.
To the team.
Exactly.
The second thing is, you mentioned something is put in the SharePoint and it is just lost. Are you not going against the basic agile process of people and interactions?
Specifically want that to happen. So what is the thing was like happening was, all these people put it, they go through it, all those things.
Right.
But the
visibility part was missing completely. Because you put it there, yes, you might go and review it once in a while, but you are not seeing it every day. Because you see every day, you find action. So one of the things which we did was, based on the discussion, we said, we are not going to put anything. We will put in retrospectives because there are people in offshore locations who want to see it, but and maybe in future reference. But what's the thing which we came out? Yep.
Who would be the prospective outcomes? Because you are saying that the Scrum Master, right, not reflecting the team's retrospective point, right? So is anybody
it's a data of the team. Let's say even if you solve everything, you look at a picture of 1 year, you will know how the team has evolved.
That's how you know, not to reflect the team's point, because nobody should really worry about what is going on with the scrum, right? It is team. Team is bringing something, and then they're going to change that subsequent sprints, if possible.
Yes,
right?
Yes, I agree.
At that point, there is a little more thing we can even discuss it. Let me finish this, wrap it up, and I'll just come back to your question. I'll just point it. Okay. So one of the points when we plan to track action items was all the points which we track, which we discussed, we assigned to different people. And we just put it like our task board. We created a separate task board for this, kept it, so that the people could go and see in the physical task board what is in progress, what is it blocked, and it was assigned to whom, whose person was working on it. It was a completely visible backlog for those people. And we had even created people like some volunteers who could go and track this. Because it was such a big initiative, we had so many people around, we can't expect one or two people to do it. So these people will individually, like we have one developer who was very much good in TDD, he said, okay, it will be his responsibility to go and teach pair program with all the other teams to improve their TDD practices. And there are, we had some issues with facility problem. So one of the Scrum Master volunteered, he will go and work with the facility with respect of all the group. So we had this volunteers for all the points which we get it, and it was visible for the team. So we were able to track it. And we are able, even though we later on we published it in SharePoint for the people to see it, but for them it was in the wall, in the Scrum team wall, where they could go it. Then once we were able to identify the big problems and a couple of the good things, which we were able to keep it up, and we had a good plan on who is going to take what actions, and how we are going to track and how they are going to get the feedback about this. And everything was happy. We said it could be the right time to close the retrospectives. And we summarized the entire event for the 2 days. We learned, we read out the key learnings, not only from the retrospective, which I, a lot of things which I explained, which I got to know the summarized, but we asked the individual people what they learned from it. They were able to share their experiences. And then we took a retrospective on the retrospective and see what could we do, improve the next time we did it. And then a couple of the volunteers who did it, that they are going to track this. They shared their contact details, even their cell number and their email address for the people, the group, so that they could contact and ask them, even if they go back to their different buildings, they could go and contact this person and see what is their action item. And then at last, we appreciated everyone's help and effort in coming out. That is a, like, this is a general format which we have used, starting from the first large retrospective. After that, we did it multiple times in different locations. Couple of the activities which I have mentioned here, I've changed, but the format would have remained almost same. And I would say it improved us a lot, because the second phase, which we did it, it was a grand success for that particular initiative. Customers were happy, and a couple of, they had like repeated contracts for us, or and for the groups, and it was a wonderful experience for them also after seeing this. So that's all from the format, all the things. If you have any questions, I can take it up. It's almost on the time. Well, first we did it in US. It was not distributed. We had all the local teams here. Came back to India also. There also we did, and we did for the local Indian teams. When we did the first thing, they were not working together.
If you have people in different locations. And
we did it once we
put the video conference. We had to, and we, at that time, we brought some people there. We went to the US, we flied out a few people down there, and we did it.
Happening at the same time, different locations?
We brought people together.
In the same location from different locations, it was a good experience. But once we did it with a small scale, where we had distributed teams in US and India, two different Scrum teams. We did it through video conferencing it. Well, it didn't give that effect, but it was okay, better than what they were doing it individually. But given a preference, I would still fly out people to the same location to do at least a retrospective. Yes. Yes. Because they were also a key stakeholder for the success of this project.
Exactly, the how they
because when they saw this, they know that their contracts was killing us. How they planned, because they give us a big bunch.
Exactly, because they were expecting,
you know, to be give us a big specifications and other things, and even though they will work with the product owners to get the story points, but they were not fully agile. They were still in that age-old model. So when they saw how their you know, actions are affecting the team in the final delivery, they were more open to change their ways, at least work with the team in a better way so that they could interact it. And how could they communicate that to the end customer? That was a key learning for them.